While world leaders meet at the UN this week for a summit on climate change, Indigenous leaders from around the world will also be there, taking part in the UN's first world conference on Indigenous peoples. Among their key concerns, keeping their natural resources intact. Kaylin Ford caught up with one woman who traveled from the Amazon to make her voice heard.
It was a journey of 3,000 miles. From her village deep in the Amazon rainforest, Patricia Gualinga has come to New York City. An Indigenous Quechua woman, Patricia is here to ask world leaders for one not-so-simple thing: to leave much of Ecuador's estimated 8 billion barrels of oil reserves in the ground.
Our people believe that petroleum is the blood of our ancestors deep in the earth, and the earth is our mother. So you're taking the blood from the mother and creating a total imbalance.
Patricia's village of Sarayaku is home to 1,200 people. And through a decades-long battle in international courts, has successfully stopped Ecuador's government from opening it up to big oil companies. Now, they want to bring that model to the rest of the world and put themselves on the front lines of the battle against climate change.
We have a proposal that's based on scientists' reports that say that 50% of the known petroleum reserves need to stay underground to avoid raising the Earth's temperature even more. So what are we waiting for? You can begin with us. We've been resisting for years. We don't want petroleum exploration. We don't want more contamination of our lands.
Patricia shared her community's struggle and victory with other Indigenous and First Nations leaders from around the world. From the Lakota of South Dakota to the Navajo of the Southwest to Native Hawaiians, each community brought gifts and shared stories of fighting for the earth. Leaders also brought water from their communities and combined it during a traditional water ceremony. Water was blessed and drunk by all, then poured back into the Hudson River.
From here on the banks of the Hudson River, Patricia and the other Indigenous leaders will take their message all the way to the United Nations on Monday and demand real action on climate change.
Chief Colleen Sisk will represent her California tribe at the UN.
The more of the Indigenous people who can be seen, and maybe we'll be heard, we don't know, you know, sometimes they only look at us, but that the states will open up their eyes and their ears and start listening and hearing.
It's a message Indigenous people say they have spent generations trying to get across, and change that they believe must begin with them.
Because we have a time-tested experience and a relationship with Mother Earth, it's just hoping that the other world will catch on to that.
Catching on before it's too late to combat climate change. Kaylin Ford, Aljazeera, New York.
Earlier this evening, I spoke to Ellen Gabriel. She's Mohawk Indian and will be attending the UN's World Conference on Indigenous Peoples. But some other communities have chosen to boycott the summit. Ellen tells us why.
First of all, because it's not a real world conference. A real world conference would have 3 days. And
this one has about a day and a half.
Yeah, it's a day and a half. And from the beginning, there has not been full and effective participation of Indigenous peoples in how to implement. There's a lot of discussion of how we can consult with Indigenous peoples. There's language that is so weak that I think from the get-go people have said, no, we don't want to be part of it. But at the same time, if we are not there to hold the line and make sure that states don't weaken the declaration, then we would be remiss to not be here. Mm-hmm. Because the declaration, I think, is an important human rights instrument for Indigenous peoples. And, you know, there's states like Canada that already have like reservations about free, prior, and informed consent, especially when it comes to extractive industries. I mean, today we had this wonderful march on climate justice, and we're talking about the continued exploitation and appropriation, theft of Indigenous people's lands right around the globe, and abuse of their rights. Mm-hmm. And the UN, I think this UN document is a lot of fluffy, flowery language that is not going to promote and protect the people's rights.
Where do you stand in your fight in trying to get your voice heard, and what would you like to see come out of this conference?
Well, this document is done. We're there to sit and watch. It's going to be, I think, very frustrating. I think what we need to look at the next steps is how the UN can help really in implementing the UN Declaration, and how do we get it in the domestic legislation of every single state that is a member of the UN, with the full and effective participation of indigenous people, with the promotion and protection of our rights in regards to protection of our lands and resources and water. Many people have said indigenous peoples are on the front line of protecting the land and the environment. We don't want just words. We want actual action, and this conference falls short of it.